Your browser might be your biggest security vulnerability, and today I want to walk you through the 10 most common security myths I've seen in the last decade. There's a ton of information out there, and a lot of it's good, some of it's not great, and so my goal is to compile all of that and give you actionable takeaways so that you learn something. Let's start with myth number one. Myth one, incognito mode makes you anonymous. In fact, Google's actually being sued right now for their misleading use of incognito mode and how they were still tracking users themselves. What incognito actually does, which browsers are getting a lot better at communicating, is it prevents local browsing history storage. So if you go to our website, techlore.tech, and you close your window and you open it back up, it won't show up in your browser history. Their Wi-Fi network can still see you access the website. The website itself can get basic information about you, like your IP address. It doesn't prevent your internet service provider from tracking you. Incognito is a great tool for its intended purpose, which is temporary local, meaning on your device privacy. But you can combine that with other strategies that we'll touch on throughout this video for maximum effectiveness. Myth number two is that HTTPS means a website is completely safe. Now, the S does stand for security in HTTPS, and when you look into your browser, it says connection is secure. You might have noticed a green lock back in the day that tried to symbolize safety of a website, but they've actually been slowly phasing this out. And the reason why they were doing this is because it was giving people a false sense of security, because malicious websites can also set up SSL certificates. My freaking dog can probably set up a site nowadays with SSL. It doesn't require anything special. So let's be very clear what HTTPS actually protects. It is connection encryption between you and the server. So in this case, if you were to go to our website or Google or DuckDuckGo, any website out there, all it's doing when you connect to those websites is guaranteeing that the data that you submit, like your passwords, is only going to that server, and it's very difficult for anybody else to actually intercept that web traffic. However, it doesn't guarantee the server itself is safe. It could have malware, it could have lots of ways of tracking you, it could just be Facebook. My point is, HTTPS is a really important technology, but do not use it as an indicator of legitimacy for a website. Now, obviously, a lack of HTTPS probably should speak to some legitimacy, but the inverse is not true necessarily. Myth number three, slower and less convenient means safer. Now, historically and to this day, I talk about a general concept that I call the convenience line, which essentially means the more private and secure you become, the less convenient your life and the actions that you take day to day become. But some people flip the reasoning on its head and say, well, if a solution is too easy or too simple, then it must not be good enough. Now, the reason why this is false is that usability and security aren't always opposites. For example, it's been shown that people can get fatigued from too many permissions that are prompting them, and they can just start giving permissions they wouldn't otherwise give. Similarly, if you go all in on the Tor browser and try to use it for everything, even your accounts, and you might just default back to Chrome. My takeaway for all of you is look for browsers and other security solutions that balance protection and usability. If Tor means you'll rage quit a CAPTCHA and open Chrome anyway, maybe find a browser that gets you halfway and offers realistic protection that you'll use throughout the day. Remember that privacy and security are a journey. It's not an overnight thing. So if you're making improvements in the right direction, you will get eventually where you want to be. Myth number four is not here to slander the Tor browser, because I love the Tor browser, but the myth is there is one best browser for privacy and security. The reality is that different browsers have different strengths and weaknesses. Every browser has pros and every browser has cons. Tor browser is fantastic for anonymity and making you blend in with other people out there, but it's extremely slow and hard to use for everything out there, especially when it comes to logging into accounts like your banks and Google. Firefox is really solid, but some people report a mixed compatibility with certain websites. Brave has pros and cons, Vivaldi has pros and cons, so it's important to embrace nuance in the browser space and try to find a browser that works for you and your specific needs and threat model, ideally more than one, and we'll talk on that later. Myth number five, Firefox is always more private than Chrome. Now, there's always some truth to these myths, and in this case, out of the box, I would overall agree. Firefox does have some good privacy advantages. It is not directly from Google. There's a lot more customization. It supports Manifest V3 still, so you can use things like full-blown uBlock Origin, which is an ad blocker and tracking protection that you can no longer use in its full capacity in Chrome because they killed that off. With that said, though, there's actually some really cool stuff on the Chrome side from a security perspective. They have some pretty solid isolation, the frequency of updates, and their ability to respond to security incidents is really incredible. And Firefox has come under some controversy for some telemetry stuff and some terms of service updates. So it's important to consider specific browser hardening guides and different things that you want to do with your browser, rather than just blanket statements like this browser is always better than this, so I'm never going to use that one. The reason why this myth is super important to debunk is not everyone in your life is going to be using your browser. So if one of your friends is using Chrome, you need to embrace this nuance so that you can at least get them to improve where they are on Chrome. We should try to meet people where they are and make improvements from them. Most of these myths don't bother me, but this one, I will be frank, does bother me a little bit because it's just very wrong and can really mislead people. The myth is you should use Google Chrome to avoid browser fingerprinting. You might be asking, what is browser fingerprinting? Essentially, everything you do and every attribute and characteristic of your browser forms a unique fingerprint that's identifiable across websites. I just made a fingerprinting masterclass which dives into how this is done, all the ways it's done, and what you can realistically do about it. A really good example of this is that when you're using Chrome, it actually reports your battery level to different websites, as well as your different settings and your different extensions and your IP address. So it's not hard for 5 different websites, if they have a shared way of communicating, to say that you are the same user across all 5 websites. Now, browser fingerprints are generally unique, and one of the common goals to help deal with this is to try to blend users in to look the same so there's more anonymity amongst the crowd of people who have the same fingerprint. But what's been born of this is the group of people who say, well, I'm going to use Google Chrome because that's the most popular browser and I'm going to look the same as everybody else on the web. This is just flat out wrong. And the reason is, even out of the box Chrome that you don't touch a single setting for, it actually lacks a ton of protections that allow sites to do some really crazy things. The way that your browser renders images is fingerprintable. The way that your GPU renders things is fingerprintable. The way audio is played is fingerprintable. Your IP address is fingerprintable. Chrome doesn't do much to prevent any of these strategies from happening. The reality is, when you're using Google Chrome, you're not using a browser with strong fingerprint resistance, whereas when you use something like Tor or Mulvad browser, or even some well-designed hardened Firefox configurations, you'll actually find that there are lots of technologies that resist fingerprinting and prevent it from happening in a verifiable way that you can test yourself. So while it's noble to try to blend in and deal with this problem, and I think we all want this problem to go away, the reality is it is not with Google Chrome, and it is with these browsers like Tor browser and Mulvad browser that are built by some of the best teams in the world who have studied this stuff for decades. And if you want to learn more about fingerprinting, I have my whole fingerprinting masterclass that is very long, thorough, and should hopefully explain anything if you have any lingering questions. I'm not going to spend too much time on this one because it's an extension of the last one, but myth 7 is that browser fingerprinting can't be mitigated. And this is a bit of like doom nihilism in the community, which is, oh my gosh, it's so sophisticated. Browser fingerprinting is crazy. There's nothing to do about it. So I'm just not going to try. I'm just going to do whatever I want on the web because it doesn't matter. I get it. Browser fingerprinting and all these sophisticated techniques of tracking people are spooky. They're scary, they almost don't sound real, but they're not as prevalent as you might think they are. There's also much more common ways of tracking and lots of low-hanging fruit. That's still how most people track users on the internet. And out of the box, Firefox has some decent privacy protections. Tor browser has phenomenal protections. Mulvad browser exists. Brave browser exists and actually tries to randomize fingerprints instead of the other ones who try to more blend users in. And the reality is there's just trade-offs between functionality and fingerprinting resistance. So perfect protection is always difficult, but significant improvements are very possible. And so yes, you can mitigate a lot of browser fingerprinting, though realistically, you will never eliminate all of it. Myth number 8, you need to install like 30 security extensions to harden Firefox or any browser to make it super secure, super private. This was previously kind of the best advice we had at the time. which is just install everything you can to block all the forms of tracking on the internet. Now, there's a couple problems with this approach. One, extensions can have conflicts, and one thing blocks the same thing as another thing, and sometimes it just breaks websites. Two, ironically, there's a lot more fingerprinting that can happen with the more extensions you have, because every extension is a fingerprintable metric. Three, performance issues. And four, this is the most important thing, modern web browsers have evolved so much, and they've actually integrated so many of these tools natively into the browser. The takeaway here is less is actually more nowadays because the tools have just gotten better and we can take advantage of that. So focus on a few essential, well-maintained extensions rather than quantity. And we do have a Firefox V2 hardening guide that takes a little bit more of this into consideration and is a lot more modernized and actually really only recommends one or two extensions, maybe. So check that out if you want to learn more about Firefox hardening and other things you can do. Another really quick myth in addition to this is myth 9, which is browser extensions only can improve security. Extensions are actually one of the most dangerous things that you install in your browser. They normally have elevated privileges, they are very easy to spoof, and we've seen some insane attacks. So be careful with extensions, they can actually introduce new risks. Be careful with permissions and access that you give extensions and keep it as minimal as possible. Nothing makes me cringe more than when I see someone's computer and they have like 20 extensions in their Chrome browser and I just go, oh my gosh. Like at least one of those is probably doing something really sketchy. So seriously, try to keep it under 5 if possible, unless you have really strong reasons to use more or they're from verifiably trusted organizations. I'm a firm believer there is no magic bullet for privacy and security and that you need to use multiple tools in different areas of your life for maximum effectiveness. And I think Redact.dev is a perfect solution that fits into a lot of people's workflows. If you've ever wanted to delete any social media accounts or specific messages or maybe just attachments in your DMs, Redact.dev helps you automatically find and delete old messages, attachments, images. The customization just lets you do whatever you want so you can actually take control of your data. It works with major platforms like Twitter and Discord. It has automated services so that you can just run it in the background. And my personal favorite feature is it lets you do things like ephemeral timelines so that maybe you're tweets get automatically deleted after a month. My favorite thing about Redact too is that it's trustless. They don't actually store your credentials on their end. It's all done locally on your machine. In fact, if you set up Redact on a second device, you have to sign into your accounts again on that device because it's all done locally on each device, so they never get your credentials. To put it simply, if you're trying to improve your digital footprint, make yourself a little more minimal, make it harder for data brokers to track you, Redact.dev is probably the best thing you can use. Visit them using the link here on the screen or down in the description. And now to our 10th myth. And of course, myth 10. Don't worry, I left a really good one, which is Tor browser makes you completely anonymous. What the Tor browser does is it actually blends you in to look like everybody else using it on the browser level as well as the network level. So it's really hard to be able to trace any users. With that said, it is not a foolproof tool. We have seen time and time again people who use Tor who get caught. Now it's really important to talk about this because some people look at these stories and go, well, this means that Tor is compromised or Tor isn't actually effective. The reality is when you actually dive into a lot of these stories, most of them included human error or some kind of indirect attack, like time correlation attacks. My point is, it doesn't matter how nice of a car you get if you don't know how to drive. And the same thing with the Tor browser, you need to know how to use it properly to actually maximize its use, because if you're just logging into your Google account using Tor, what are you really keeping yourself anonymous from? Try to avoid logging into personal accounts tied to you. Don't install extra extensions in the Tor browser. It's out of the box the way it needs to be. Don't do anything illegal. Don't do anything that obviously reveals who you are. And just be smart and vigilant because, like any browser, you can still infect yourself with nasty things if you download the wrong program or you access the wrong website. And so remember that Tor browser can make you extremely anonymous and it's a very powerful tool, but it requires understanding and it will never make you 100% anonymous because nothing ever will. and that's okay. Those are all the myths, but here are some tips and principles that everybody should think about regardless of who you are and what you're doing. First, remember there is no perfect browser. There's simply different browsers that accomplish different things for different people, and in fact, many of you could probably benefit from using multiple browsers. Next, make sure to balance security with usability. Again, it doesn't matter how secure it is if you never use it and you end up reverting to something worse anyway. Third, whatever browser you choose, make sure that it's getting active security updates. There are a lot of forks of projects out there. Some of them no longer get updated. Some of them have delayed security updates. But when you have vulnerable software like browsers, when we see 0 days, we want those 0 days patched within a day tops. Of course, the bonus final myth is that you don't need to care about browser security at all. You do. It's important. It's probably a thing that's gonna screw you over. If you like this video, definitely give it a like. Let me know which myth resonated with you down in the description. I wanna thank Redact.dev for not only offering a great service that I can wholeheartedly recommend, but also for sponsoring what we're doing and making this possible. But I also wanna thank our Techlorians, who's our community that lets us be independent and put whatever content we want together and be really picky with our sponsors. So it really is a community effort that makes all this content possible. So I wanna thank everybody here watching, and I want to thank everybody behind the scenes who's been supporting our work along the way. I'll see you next time on Techlore, and yeah, leave me your favorite myth down in the description. See you next time.